Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel Deep Understanding of Research Papers. Today in this tutorial I will explain a recent paper called Wave to Wake, Unsupervised Pre-training for Speech Recognition by Stefan Schneider, Alexey Bevsky, Ronan Collabort and Michael Olley. So the paper is coming from Facebook AI Research. Maybe many people will be knowing about Ronan Collabort. He is a pioneer of NLP for deep learning. And deep learning for NLP, and he has got many awards. Also he received a Test of Time award for his work on NLP using deep learning. And today I will explain this paper Wave to Wake, and I'll explain in the following fashion. So first we'll explain the overview of this paper, then we'll see this pre-training approach which they are using for training a model which can give some features which are very useful for doing speech recognition, and we'll see some experiments, and finally we'll see some results. So as I said, this paper is mostly about unsupervised pre-training. So pre-training is about training one model, assume some neural network, using unsupervised data. When I say unsupervised data, let's say you have a lot of audio data, just the audio data, no text or anything. How can we make use of this large amount of audio data and train a model which can understand some high level features, or which can give us some high level features of this speech data, so that we can add some few layer or train another model using small amount of data, right? And so that the model performance is better using these features instead of using low level features. So assume this sort of gives us some high level features, and this, as I said, this is unsupervised pre-training. So when I say unsupervised pre-training, you just need the audio data, and which we can get from online a lot, like in YouTube for example, you get huge amount of audio data, but you might not get labeled data, which is audio plus text. For that we might need to employ some people and ask them to write the transcript to do the training. But here we are going to train this model using only audio data. Then we will fine tune it for our use case, where we can collect very small amount of audio data and text, and train our supervised model. So assume it has some semi-supervised algorithm, and this model is trained using multilayer CNN, and the model is trained, the loss function which is used is a contrastive binary classification task. If you remember work by Aaron Vanderwood work, which is he's from DeepMind, his work on CPC, basically contrastive predictive coding, this algorithm falls into the same class actually. So the idea is borrowed from this paper itself. Contrastive predictive coding is basically about predicting the future samples, or predicting the future by observing the past and the present. So if you do that way, and whatever features you are going to learn will be much robust. And there was one more paper which recently came out from James Class lab, which is MIT's lab, MIT speech lab. They also did some work on this in the same line, CPC, but they are called APC. APC stands for autoregressive predictive coding. So the CPC is basically contrastive predictive coding. They were using some encoders and something, encoders like VAEs and all, to get the high level features. And by doing the they get those features, so very good features of phonemes, graphemes, words, syllables and all, by doing the future prediction. But these guys argued instead of embedding audio into high level features and then predicting is not a good idea. Instead, we should use directly raw waveform and directly predict the audio samples. So some interesting work, you can take a look at it. If you just search for APC and CPC, you will get the papers. You can just read them later. But this algorithm falls in the same line. This algorithm also takes some idea from CPC, where the idea is to predict the future from the past. This might look like linear predictive coding, but not exactly linear predictive coding, but assume something similar to that. But we are going to predict k samples ahead. Like, let's say we have predicted so much, and when we are here, we are going to try predicting k future samples so that this might not need any label data, right? Because we are just taking the audio data and then using the same audio data. We don't need any labels, or we don't need any text for this. So once you train this sort of model, then whatever features we get, those are robust, and those will give some high-level feature representation which we can use for the downstream tasks. And as I said, the loss function uses contrast to binary classification. We'll see why that contrast to binary classification is used. Aaron Vanderwood, when he published this paper, he had his own theory about. He actually looks this problem in terms of information theoretic way. He has his own theory of why contrast to binary classification should work instead of normal classification. You can read his paper on that. And the experiments were conducted on WSJ. They show they actually get better performance compared to state of the art using this algorithm, even with the character rate and even LER and AWR also. The baseline is going to be the log mill filter bank energy baseline. Basically, log mill filter bank is a feature representation of the audio, and we are going to assume we get the features from unsupervised model instead of log mill filter bank. And also in the simulated low resource setup, they get a very good improvement. This is actually a very good paper on transfer learning, I would say. You can think this paper as a transfer learning paper, and you can use the same algorithm to do the pre-training, then use those features to do transfer learning. So this sort of looks like transfer learning, and the experiment they have showed is if you even if you have a small amount of data, labeled data, you can still get much better performance compared to just the baselines, which are like old models. So as I said, the idea of this paper is to predict the future from the context. Context could be the previous samples or the current sample. You just want to make the future prediction. And the idea is to just encode the audio samples into some high-level representation. Let's say you have some audio. You just use an encoder and encode it to some higher-level representation. Let's say you have a lot of samples and you get samples at the frame rate of the 10 millisecond here. These are called Z-dice, and Z is because of latent. Z is basically represents sort of a latent variable. You might have seen this in generative modeling, where, for example, VAEs and GANs and autoregressive flows, etc. So the Zi is actually the Z was actually borrowed from the same paper, I think, the CPC paper, because Z is basically sort of looks like sort of like latent variable, but here it's not a latent variable. You can just think of it some encoder output. Right, and these ZIs are let's say I go to 1 to 100. These ZIs will be low frame rate compared to the audio itself. Audio will have 16,000 samples, 16,000 samples per second, but these will be maybe 100 vectors per second, right? So that way, and we are interested in modeling the density, which is basically probability of ZI plus K, which is the future sample. Kth, let's say we are at 10th time frame, we want to know what is the 11th sample given the previous R samples. A context could be R context. R could be like 10 samples, previous samples. We want to do the prediction K step ahead by looking at the context, which can be 10 step, right? So that is the idea. And this model, again said, as I said, the training is done in this way. Like we take the audio and encode it to some space, which is Zi space. From Zi, we again try to reconstruct. So that's why they're saying here their model is two networks. So the encoder network actually embeds our audio signal into latent space, and the context network is basically combines multiple timestamps, which are these, and try to make the contextual presentation. I mean, basically, it tries to get the contextualized representation of it, right? So we'll see the detailed architecture of this problem algorithm in the coming slides, but this is the whole idea, right? So as I said, this is it. This is the approach they are trying to use here. So as I said, you have AX, which is basically a raw audio waveform, right? This is a highly varying signal, which has a 16, for example, 16 kilohertz signal, which is 16,000 samples per second. And the encoder basically is a function which can be any neural network. In this case, assume it's a convolutional neural network. Is a function mapping from X space to the Z space, right? So this is assumes it take convolution it is a convolutional neural network takes sequence of audio samples and goes to Z space, right? That's why the function F maps the X, which is the audio, into Z, which is our latent space embeddings, right? So as I said, the F function is parameterized using 5-layer CNN as it's shown here, and this is sort of similar to Aaron Vanderwood 2018 paper. So the filter sizes are given here. If you want, you can go through it. Kernel sizes are given here with the stride, this one, and the ZIs, whatever the signal we are observing here, this is the frame rate is lower compared to the XX. Because this is 16,000 samples per second, this is just assume if it is 10 milliseconds, it's just 100 frames per second, right? Because you'll have only 100 samples in 1 second, right? As they are saying here, right? So basically that is the whole idea. We just want to reduce the dimensionality of the audio because we can't deal with the audio because the audio is a very high dimensional data, right? Now once we get this Z, now let's say we are at this point. At this point, we want to make a prediction to the future samples, or we want to know the future future samples. So for that, what we do is we apply another network, which is called context network. So this context network is again a neural network. It's a function mapping basically maps Z. Function is G, and the function G maps the Z space, which is this space, into C space, which is called contextualized representation. So that is the whole idea, right? So that's why this is, as I said, this is encoder network, and this is context network. Now from the context, you can actually predict the future samples, or these are losses. This is not samples. From the context, you can get these L1, L2, L3. Which I am going to explain it in the coming slide. These are losses, and the combining all these losses, we can do the backpropagation, right? So as it's seen here, the context network takes multiple representations, which are Zi to the previous, let's say V representation. If V is equal to 3, then it takes these three, and try to get this Ci, right? So as shown here, this is Ci, for example. So if I equal to 10 and V is 3, then we are going to be looking at Z7, Z8, Z9, right? These three representation. And that is basically is sort of called receptive field also. So the receptive field is 210 milliseconds, is what is chosen in this paper. So this is the whole idea. So it's a simple, like you have encoder, which takes audio, embeds into some space, which is low frame rate. 10 millisecond, you get, let's say if your audio is 16 kilohertz, you get, you have 10,000 samples in the with an input to the encoder, and the encoder spits out 100 samples, 100 vectors, for example. So these 100 vectors basically comes for every second, and these 100 vectors again combined into context based on the receptive field we have, and again reduced to dimension, right? Now, how do we train it? So the training is done here. Like this. So what the algorithm tries to do is it tries to instead of predicting it tries to distinguish the future samples from random samples in the data. This is also called this is also known as you might have seen this in for example word to vec paper noise contrast estimation. During noise contrast estimation we do that. So that's the same thing here. We want to know, or we want to distinguish the actual samples, which are Zi plus K sample. Let's say Zi plus K, if K equal to 1, 2, 3 and I equal to 10, you have let's say Z10, Z11 and Z12. So these three samples, I want to create a model which actually takes these, instead of predicting these samples, it actually tries to distinguish between the future samples and other samples, right? So that's why it's called noise. This is called contrastive loss. It's just for example, you might have seen this in other. You might see the same kind of thing in other problems also. Like for example, in computer vision, you have a triplet loss. Or in same-ish network, you have the same problem. If two samples are same, you will reduce the distance between those two samples or two vectors. And if they are different, you will try to push them apart. Right, so that is contrastive loss again. So I mean, like that, there is many others algorithms, or like say triplet loss, CMS networks, contrastive loss, hinge loss. So those all does the same thing, and this the same thing is done here also. So instead of predicting them, we just want to we just want to distinguish between the feature samples and distractor samples. So the distractor samples are drawn from this proposal distribution called PN, which is basically the like you can uniformly take all the samples in the audio data. For example, let's say you have 100 ZIs in your audio data. Once you feed the audio data, then you can randomly take maybe 10 distractor. So randomly take these are called distractors. Z tilde. The randomly taken 10 vectors are distinguished from these future samples, right? So that is the overall idea. So if my future prediction is capital K steps, this capital K could be 3, 10, whatever. I want to create these losses. So basically for every K equal to 1 to, let's say, 10, if my capital K is 10, I want to create this loss. This loss is looks very simple, as you can see here. Sorry about this this picture, it's coming in the middle. So this I is actually, for example, 1 second. So assume I is actually coming from, I is the current time step, right? Let's say I is the current time step, and I want to compute, I want to find next, I want to find out the Z's which are K step ahead. So if I is, let's say, 10, this is the I, as you can see here. I want to compute this term, which is sort of like a log of the sigmoid, and sigmoid of some x actually looks like this, because this is the equation, as everybody knows about this. So this basically gives us the probability of zi plus k, if k equal to 1 is zi plus 1, being the true sample, right? This is the probability. And the distractor samples are coming like this. The distractor samples are drawn from a distribution called PN. And you take the expectation over log of sigmoid of this term, which is basically, it's a distractor sample, right? It's a probability of the distractor sample. Now you sum these two probabilities and take negative of it. Negative is because you want to minimize the loss. This actually I want to maximize it, but we always minimize the loss in the training, during training, because using stochastic gradient descent. I will take negative of this, right? Negative of this term. And this is for k equal to 1, for example, and if I have 10k, I will get 10 different losses, right? L1, L2, L3, like that. And I will just take, for the total loss, I'll just take the sum of mean of all the losses, LK, right? And the PN, actually, PN of Z comes from some uniform distribution. Capital T could be the length of your audio data, right? That's all it is. And lambda is the number of negatives you want to say. Let's say I want to say take 10 distractor samples. You just set lambda equal to 10. If it is different, you just set it accordingly. So you can do different experiments. So this is the whole idea. So you get different LK for different Ks. K could be the future samples, and capital K could be 10. That means you want to know, you want to find the contrastive loss for the next 10 future samples, right, from the current time step. So coming to the experiments, they are using TIMIT data, WSJ-1 data, and LibriSpeech data. We'll see the results for these data sets. So for training this acoustic model, they use 80 dimensional log filter bank energies computed for every 25 millisecond window with a stride of 10 millisecond. So this is used in wave to letter plus model, which is actually an invention from same team, which is actually from Facebook AI. So they're taking the wave to letter model, and they are computing this log filter bank energies for this model as a baseline. So for the baseline, you use melt filter mechanisms for a wave to letter model, right? Simple. And they say all the acoustic models are trained on 8 V100 GPUs, like very costly GPUs. And the implementation is actually available in FairSig toolkit, which you can go and explore if you want. It's there in FairSig, as a part of FairSig toolkit. And for a language model, they use 4-gram language model. They have also used, they have different types of language model. One is using a simple 4-gram based language model, classical. And they also trained a character based LM model using convolutional neural network and also another model. We'll see that in the coming slides. And also decoding step is like this, very simple. Decoding step is you compute the acoustic model score, you compute the language model score, and you scale the language model score based on some parameter called alpha. And also you want to know the length of your hypothesis, which can be multiplied by some parameter called beta. And this is one more time, which is actually gives you like how much silence is there in the audio. So basically you want to maximize this whole term, not just this. I think there is a bracket mistake. You want to maximize this whole term. So this FMAC basically gives the acoustic score, and this is language model score, and this is some sort of like regularization kind of terms. This is all I want to maximize using beam search, right? Coming to the results, these are the results they have compared with previous systems. Basically they wanted to compute the WR for test data of WSJ, and as you can see here, both for validation and test. This is a previous system. They have directly computed the LER and WER for these two dev and test data. As you can see here, Deep Speech 2, which is actually Voidu's paper, Deep Speech 2 paper, which got actually 4.42, but they have used huge amount of label data, which might not be possible to even collect by researchers, because it's a huge amount of data, and they have compared with other systems also. This actually looks best. It's reasonable. Why? Because they have used such amount of data, and WER is 3.1. There is no LER for this, but fine. And they have compared with different LMs. As I said, they have used three different language models. One is Foregram, one is word based convolutional neural network language model, another is character based language model. So as you can see, the LER, which is letter error rate, is actually best for character convolution, but it does not, it's not much different compared to classical Foregram or Ngram based language model. It's a very small amount of change, and these are the data sets used for pre-training. As you can see, this is a WaveTech pre-training, and WaveTech Large uses the full 960 hours of audio data, right? This is all the results. You can go through more results, I mean, understand this table more in the paper if you want. And there is one more very nice experiment. As I was saying, you can do transfer learning, or even for domain adaptation also, I think you can do transfer learning for speech recognition using this model. How? You can see, if you have very small amount of label data, let's say eight hours of label data, if you train the baseline model, which is just take the log filter bank energy, and if you train a wave to letter model, you actually get this number, which is 23% WER. But if you do the wave to wave pre-training with LibreSpeech data and you train the model, you get very low, like 13% WER, which is like very good, like a lot of improvement, like almost 10% absolute improvement in the WER, right? And same thing happens with other training data also. But as you can see here, if you can understand very easily here, as you increase the amount of data, they might come closer. I mean, the difference is lower. But if you are in a low resource condition, let's say you want to do speech recognition for some of the Indian languages, it's very hard to get data sets, first of all. I mean, you won't get data more than 30 hours. There is some three language data set, but those are all research purpose data sets. But if you are in a company and you want to build a speech recognition, you need a lot of data, but you might not get a lot of unlabeled data. So that way you can just use small amount, you can do the unsupervised pre-training and then fine tune it for small amount of data, right? This is a very nice thing. I liked it in this paper. And also they have compared some PR results also, like phoneme error rate for timid data set. They have compared with Mirko Ravanelli's old works. Is thesis, I think. He's done a lot of work in this LI lightweight, I think. I'm not sure the full name of this LI GRU, but I have read the paper before. But these were the state of the art at that point of time. He was getting 14 point some PER for timid. That was the state of the art at that time. But these guys are also showing, if you do the pre-training with LibreSpeech and WSJ, you actually beat the state of the art, which is like this. You can see here, I mean, a little bit improvement, but not that that much. But they show that this pre-training actually helps, right? And that's all for this video. Thank you so much for watching this tutorial. If you're not subscribed to my channel, please subscribe. for more content, and thank you.